Welcome to all the participants for the 26th webinar organized by Rajapalayam Rajesh College Nature Club and coordinated with WAR, Wildlife Association of Rajapalayam. It's a national level webinar on gentle giants of the ocean on celebrating International Whale Shark Day on August 31 by Surgeon John, Head Marine Wildlife Trust of India, Noida, NCR, India. Welcome, sir. It's the time to intro our resource person. It's a big honor to have this person today on our webinar. Surgeon John is a marine biologist who joined the Wildlife Trust of India in 2014. He currently heads the Marine Conservation Project, which includes the Whale Shark Conservation Project in Gujarat, Kerala, and Lakshadweep, the Coral Reef Recovery Project in Gujarat, and the Mangrove Conservation Project in Northern Kerala. Sir, welcome, sir.
Thank you.
Thank you, sir. The session is on your hands, sir.
Okay. Thank you, Ramji. So I'll share the screen. Hope the screen is shared.
Yes, sir. Visible, sir.
Is it visible? Okay. Thank you.
Okay.
Thank you, Ramji. Thank you all the participants for your precious time here. I would like to start the talk with an apology because I was supposed to be with you a couple of days before, but due to some unforeseen events, I had to postpone this talk. Big apology for that thing. Me and Ramji were talking about this particular talk for quite some time. We thought that we will schedule the talk on whale sharks on the International Whale Shark Day, which is on August 30th. But somehow it didn't materialize. And today we are talking about the whale shark with whale sharks on Teachers Day. So hopefully I'll be able to interact with you and we can learn quite a lot of things about the whale sharks on the Teachers Day. So, well, before starting the talk about the gentle giants of the ocean, about the whale sharks, I would be talking a little bit about the sharks. I'll be introducing sharks to you. So without the proper understanding of the sharks, you won't be able to understand whale sharks. So you have to have a clear understanding about sharks. So if you have a clear understanding about the sharks, you can save them, you can protect them, you can care for them. So I will be talking about sharks and a little bit of the taxonomy part, a little bit of the classification part, not in detail, but briefly I'll be talking about that. Okay, so to start with, the superclass pisces or the fishes is divided into two groups. One is bony fish. Okay, bony fish have their skeleton made up of proper calcified bones. And the other group is cartilaginous fishes, which have the skeletal structure made out of cartilage, which is not hard as a bone, but it's very soft tissue. So today we will be largely talking about sharks, and in that group itself, the cartilaginous fishes are known as elasmobranchs. And there are three groups of elasmobranchs are there. One is sharks, second is rays, and the third one is skates. So it's very easy to identify rays and skates because they are dorsoventrally flattened. And nobody will be able to kind of misidentify a ray and a skate. So, but today's talk, I will be largely looking into the sharks. And there are nearly 500 odd species of sharks available in the global ocean. So to start with, what is the feeling you have when we hear about the word sharks? So I would like to say that the Hollywood film industry have generously contributed lots of movies that have created a panic when we hear about sharks. And most of the shark movies made by the Hollywood depicts sharks as really blood hungry monsters, chasing the people, eating them, ripping them apart. So whenever we hear about sharks, the first thing coming to our mind is danger, because we really are scared of sharks. So that's the next question. Whether sharks are really our friend or really our enemy. So if you want to understand these things, you should clearly understand what exactly sharks are doing in the ecosystem. So as I told you, we have already something close to 500 species of sharks, and all the sharks have a particular role to play in the ecosystem. I think most of you will be familiar with the food web. Here I have shown a picture of marine food pyramid. So this food pyramid is almost same like a terrestrial food pyramid, which where we have a towards the base we have the producers, and the way we go up we have multiple layers of consumers. So here the position of the sharks in the marine food pyramid is at the top. So the sharks are the apex predators on the food pyramid. So once you are on the top of the food pyramid, you have certain roles to perform. So it's just like a tiger in the terrestrial environment. So what are the roles and responsibilities of a shark in the marine ecosystem? So we have to understand that thing in the first. So mainly the sharks have three ecological importance. One is to kind of balance the food web, which I have already talked about. The second thing is to keep the prey population healthy. And the third one is to keep the coastal habitats healthy. So what will happen is that if there are over explosion of certain undesired species, what will happen is that they will literally consume all the available food resources in the ocean. So sharks, what will do is that they will keep a check on the over explosion of these kind of unwanted fishes and other species. In that way, they control or they balance the food web. The second thing is that they keep the healthy population of the prey species. Say, for example, marine turtles are a prey for sharks. Only very few species can literally eat marine turtles because of its calcified exoskeleton, the shells, right? So what will happen is that, say, if there is an injured animal, or animal which is having diseases, what will happen is that the chances of them contributing towards the population is much higher. So that kind of unwanted trait will get into the gene pool. So what these sharks does is they'll control these kind of unwanted entry of genes into the gene pool. So they'll ensure that the prey population is healthy by controlling these kind of unwanted gene flow. And the third thing is about habitat role. So the first two things about the balancing of the food webs or to maintain the healthy prey species, you can see that the sharks are largely helping to control the species specific, the sharks have interaction with the species. But they also have a really good interaction with the habitats. So if you understand the marine ecology, there is life under the blue water and there is life beneath also, so towards the bottom part. So there are lots of habitats, say like there are sea grasses, seaweeds, coral reefs. And if you come to the coastal region or near shore water, there is something called mangroves, mangrove ecosystem. So the marine ecosystem is very varied. Okay, so it's very diverse. So what will happen is that if there is unwanted explosion of certain species, okay, that can have an adverse effect on these kind of habitats. Say again, I'll take an example of turtle here again. So green turtle is a grazer, so they largely feed on the sea grasses. And seagrasses are a best nursery ground for small fishes. So what will happen is that if there is an uncontrolled grazing of seagrasses by these sea turtles, especially the green sea turtles, the seagrass meadow will disappear. And the young fishes or these juvenile fishes or the baby fishes won't be having any place to hide. So the nursery grounds for these baby fishes will disappear. So if the baby fishes are not there, what will happen is that the adult fishes will be missing from that region. If the adult fishes are not there in that region, that will be adversely affecting the livelihood of the people who are directly dependent on these kind of resources. Okay, so it's important to keep a check on the explosion of all the over explosion of the population of the green sea turtles. So as I told you, only very an adult turtle have only very few natural predator, and shark is one of the natural predator of green sea turtles. So what the sharks does is that they eat the marine turtles and keep the population of the marine turtles at a check. So what will happen is that if there is a controlled or a regulated grazing for the marine turtles, there will be enough place for the baby fishes to grow, and the seagrass will be healthy. The people who are dependent on this kind of fishery will be healthy. So sharks are very, very important for a marine ecosystem to thrive. So I would like to call them as the engineers of the ocean. So their contribution may not be kind of very visible, but the thing is that they are kind of really helping the ocean, also the people who are dependent on the various resources of the ocean. But what exactly we are doing to sharks? That's the question is. So as I told you, there are lots of ecological importance for the sharks, but actually are we helping them or are we threatening them? So you know that sharks are commercially exploited. The shark meats are consumed all along the coast, say from Gujarat to West Bengal, all along the Indian coastline, which is closely 8,000 kilometer. People consume shark. So sharks are commercially exploited all along the Indian coast as well as globally. But another thing, why are we exploiting the shark? So one of the major thing you must have heard about something called shark fin soup. Shark fin soup is a delicacy in the Southeast Asian region. So they make soup out of the shark fin. So for that, they largely use the dorsal fin, the pectoral fin and the caudal fin, the tail part, the fin on the tail region. And they'll make these exotic soups out of that thing. And these soups are very sought after. So the people who drinks this soup, they believe that. They, again, I would like to use the term believe. So it's not scientifically proven, but they like to believe that if you consume the shark fin soup, that will help them to kind of, what do you say, get over with many ailments, and their longevity will increase and other things. So these are largely misconception. So there are no scientific proof for this thing. But these sort of delicacies are progressively pushing these species towards extinction. So the thing is that I would also like to kind of tell you a little bit of facts. This is not an updated fact. This is talking about for last 40 odd years, okay, there have been reports of 400 and close to 500 fatal sharks attack in the world. So if you convert that into per year data or per year statistics, you will get that in any year there is 1% is killed by sharks globally. But what are we doing to sharks? Okay, in 1 year humans kill almost 100 million sharks. So that's a huge number. So here I would like to kind of pose a question. Who is the real monster? Even though we are showcasing sharks as a real monster in movies, but in real life, who is the real monster? Is the shark the real monster? All the human beings, we human beings are the real monster. So that's the question I am asking you. You can answer it later. So that's the whole point of my talk here. We clearly understand that, what is it, the sharks are least understood species. Most of the time, what we think about sharks are not really true. And the thing is that we have to admit that the major issue here is that ignorance. The people think about sharks as a predator, as a monster, as a killer, but that's not the real thing. So nobody literally understands the sharks. So if you want to love sharks, if you want to care sharks, if you want to protect sharks, first thing is that you should understand them. So that is the whole purpose of having this kind of webinar, and there is this small attempt done by the Ramji and the effort you guys all have put together to understand about the sharks. Now from here onwards, I'll be talking about the whale shark. Whale shark, and here also I'll talk about the effort which we have taken to conserve the whale shark along the coast of Gujarat, and little bit about the natural history and all the other details of the whale sharks in detail. So as I have mentioned earlier, whale shark is the largest fish living on the planet Earth. It can grow up to 18 meters and weigh close to 21 tons. And if I put it into perspective, I can clearly say that if you have seen a Volvo bus, the adult whale shark can grow to a size of a Volvo bus. Okay, so that is the size of the whale shark. And as I told you, we have progressively pushed this species close to extinction. So till 2016, IUCN categorized this species as vulnerable. But what happened is that during the 2016 assessment, we understood that the population of whale shark is drastically declining due to unsustainable fishing practices for their fins, for their liver oils, and also lots of these accidental entanglements. So because of those reasons, from vulnerable, the whale shark has been moved to endangered. So this is not a really good sign of progress. The more it move towards the right hand side, it will become critically endangered, then it become extinct. So we really don't want to push this species close to extinction. So another important thing is that I would like to say whale sharks are really primitive fishes. Another thing is that if you look into the entire ancestry of the whale shark, you can see that the whale shark have been in this planet since the evolution of sharks. So almost from the period of Jurassic to Cretaceous period, the whale shark are there. And they're the ancestors of whale sharks are there. And they are close to something like 200 million years ago. And as I told you, these are one of the largest fish in the world. So, but the interesting part is that being one of the largest fish on the planet Earth and one of the fish which is really old, dating back to Jurassic period, almost like 200 million years ago, this is one of the recent addition towards the knowledge of the humankind. Very recently only whale shark have been identified. So the whale shark has been identified and described by a scientist called Andrew Smith during 1828 from a specimen from South Africa. So if you look into the global distribution of whale sharks, you can clearly see that whale sharks are tropical species. So they love to be in the waters which is not very cold. So they prefer the waters which are prefer the tropics and subtropical region. And if you look into the little bit about the biology and ecology of the species, unlike other shark species, whale shark is the only shark which have very distinctive body patterns and body markings. If you look into any other sharks, leave this rays and scales apart. Rays and scales have really beautiful designs. Okay, they have really really good patterns on them. So like dots, stripes, and various honeycomb designs and all. So leaving the rays and scales apart, but if you take the sharks all together, sharks are not very bright. So they don't have that kind of body patterns. So whale shark is the only shark which is having a really unique body patterns like dots and stripes. So even though how bad your taxonomy is, how bad your identification is, nobody can misidentify a whale shark because whale shark is very easy to identify. And these dots and stripes actually help the animal to kind of create a camouflage so that it can escape the predators when they are young. for an adult whale shark being a size of a Volvo bus, no animal can hurt them apart from human beings. And another unique thing is that all these stripes and these dot patterns of the whale sharks are very, very unique. So just like the fingerprint, or just like the stripes of the tiger, the dots and lines of the whale sharks are very unique, and you can clearly identify individuals based on the these dots and stripes. And another important and one of the interesting feature about the whale shark is that even though being the largest fish on the planet Earth, it eats the smallest thing on the world. Okay, so it feeds the fish eggs, fish larvae, planktons, phytoplankton, zooplankton, larvae of crabs, jellyfishes, etc. So the interesting part is that they, even though they are predators, they are filter feeders. So how they feed is that they'll open their mouth, take lots of water into their mouth, and they'll filter it. They'll strain it using the gills on the either side of their body. So the gills will strain the food particles which is trapped on the gills. Okay, so this is a unique feature of the whale shark. Whale shark is a filter feeder. So apart from whale shark, there are another two more filter feeders. One is basking shark and another one is megamouth. So only three species of filter feeders are alive right now are basking shark, megamouth shark, and the famous whale shark. If you talk a little bit about the reproduction of whale shark or shark in general, I would like to say that we have mainly three type of reproduction you can see on the sharks. One is viviparous. Viviparity is something like just like the normal childbirth in the case of mammals. So the mother shark will give birth to the baby sharks. It's simple. The second thing is oviparous. Oviparous is just very common, just like the fishes. The mother shark will go and find ideal places. The mother shark will identify the suitable places. They'll go there and lay the eggs. And when the environment factors are very conducive, the babies will hatch out of the eggs. That's the oviparous. And there's a third method by which they reproduce is known as ovoviviparous. So I would like to say that this is a hybrid between the viviparous and the oviparous. So the whale sharks are oviviviparous. So what is oviviviparous? So the female whale shark will be having growing embryo inside their stomach, and instead of laying the eggs, these eggs will hatch inside the body cavity of the female, and then the live young ones will come out of the mother whale shark. So it looks as if the mother whale shark is giving birth to the live young ones, but it's not true. It's basically the eggs within the body cavity hatching out and the babies are coming out. So it's a mix of viviparous and oviparous. So we call it as ovoviviparous. So whale sharks are ovoviviparous creatures. And the fourth one, it's very, very rare. We call it as parthenogenesis. It's not very, very common in the common shark reproductive method. So we'll call it as parthenogenesis. And the thing is that certain species of sharks are known to do this thing, but not very commonly. The embryo will be developed without the help of a male shark. So it's a very rare thing. But if you look into I'm coming back to the whale shark. So whale sharks are generally known as gentle giant because they are very big and very gentle. They don't attack human beings and they don't have any kind of predatory instincts like other sharks. But it does also have other name that is known as mega mama. So a adult gravid female of whale shark can have something close to 300 whale shark babies inside her. So you can see the picture here towards the right hand side. This is a picture from taken from Taiwan. An accidentally caught adult gravid female was cut open, and they got almost like 300 embryos of different life stages from the female adult whale shark. So that's the reason why we call a female adult whale shark as Maga Mama. So the thing is that one of the other question mostly the people ask that how can you understand that the whale shark became an adult whale shark, because you cannot closely observe this thing. So you, here you can see the picture of a pregnant whale shark which has been taken from Galapagos Island. So the recent study done by the scientists from Australia says that the male whale sharks attain the sexual maturity when they are above 9 meters. So 9 meters is almost kept as the benchmark. Okay, so this is almost true for females also. So males and females of whale shark, which they have the size of 9 meters, above 9 meters, we can say that they are becoming sexually mature. But the another interesting fact is that those are limited information which we know, but we really don't know when these whale shark mates were as whale shark mates and where these baby whale sharks are given birth. So as I told you, the whale shark is the largest fish, but it is very elusive fish. Our understanding about this fish is really, really less. So coming to India now. So I will talk about the real success story of the whale shark conservation, which I am involved and my team is involved with Wildlife Trust of India. So along the Indian coast, all along the 8,000 kilometer of Indian coast, we will get to see whale sharks. So whale shark is fairly common all along the Indian coast. But especially in Gujarat, the northwestern coast of Gujarat, in a place called Saurashtra, there is an aggregation of whale shark. Okay, so that aggregation is basically from October to April. So nobody clearly knows that why whale shark aggregate in the Gujarat coast. So no clear explanation for that thing. Apart from Gujarat also, we have these aggregations, whale shark aggregations along Maharashtra coast, Karnataka coast, Lakshadweep coast. And if you come to the east coast, we have the aggregations along the Andhra coast also. But the largest aggregations of whale shark in India is along the Gujarat coast. So here you can see a picture of the aggregation size, the yellow mark here. You can see that is the aggregation spot. Where will you, in that region, you will get to see whale sharks from the time of October to April every year. So what exactly happened? So because of this aggregation happening, the people in Gujarat, I'll say that the fisher folks along the Gujarat, they started to kill the whale sharks. Okay, so what happened is that people started to kill whale shark. This, as I told you, this is a, one of the largest fish on the planet Earth, such a magnificent creature. It takes almost like 9 meters to become a sexually mature individual. So there are lots of unique life history traits are also there. So the thing is that unknowingly, the fisher folks of Gujarat used to hunt these whale sharks. So these are some images of whale shark hunting that existed before. It's not a present situation. This is a past photograph. The people used to kill whale shark intentionally along the coast of Gujarat. So that was the time when there is a movie maker called Mike Pandey. He made a movie called Shores of Silence. So the Shores of the Silence was an eye-opener. So it clearly depicted the plight of the whale sharks along the Gujarat coast. So that was the time. That was movie was released in 2000, and that movie got the Green Oscar Award also later next year. So that movie actually showcased the real scenario, what was happening in the Gujarat for the whale sharks. So it was really pathetic in Gujarat at that time. So at that time, then Wildlife Trust of India decided that we have to save the whale sharks. So saving whale shark is not an easy task. So we thought that we'll club with other eco-conscious corporates like Tata Chemicals, and the Gujarat Forest Department also joined hands. And there was some level of policy level intervention happened. So if you want to know that whale shark is the first fish in India to be declared under the Schedule 1 of the Indian Wildlife Protection Act. So during 2001, this species became the first Schedule 1 species on the fish part. So presently, whale shark is enjoying the protection like an elephant, a tiger, or a rhino. So, but the protection is on paper. The people are still killing the whale shark. So we realize that, okay, the people need to be made aware about the ecological importance and the legal status of the whale shark. So that was the time there was a massive project on the whale shark conservation started along the Gujarat coast. So the first major thing was that I'm talking about whale sharks. So I'm going and talking to the people about the whale sharks. The first question is that how big is the whale shark? I am telling that whale shark is a big fish. But the thing is that unless until you see something, you won't be able to gauge the dimensions of that thing. So first of all, we wanted to say that, okay, whale shark is a big fish. People were finding it very difficult to kind of relate how big a big fish is. So to make that thing possible, we made a large 40-foot size inflatable, okay, exactly like a whale shark. And we showed them, okay, the fish we are talking about, the fish the fisher folks are killing about is a fish of this size. Okay, it's something close to 40 feet. It's a huge fish. So first of all, if you want to kind of save something, if you want to kind of protect something, you should have an idea how big or how small that animal is. So for that particular purpose, we made this whale shark inflatable. And we took this whale shark inflatable all along the coast and we told them that, okay, this is a large fish and you are not supposed to kill it because it's having illegal protection as well. And another thing is that not only the fisher folks, we also targeted the next generation, the young ones. Okay, there are lots of students. So all along the Gujarat coast for almost like 15, 16 years, we have almost touched upon close to 1.5 lakhs of students. So every year during the International Whale Shark Day, we used to have multiple activities along with the students. So to keep them engaged and keep them aware about the ecological importance of the whale sharks. So the campaign was so huge that within a span of 1 year itself, we started to get the result. So this campaign started in 2004 along the Gujarat coast. And by 2005 itself, what happened is that the fisher folks started to cut the net and release the whale shark. So we used multiple methods of campaign. We used a religious leader, or I'll call it as a spiritual leader. We used the help of the spiritual leader Morari Bapu. So he also talked about the whale shark need to be protected because whale shark is one avatar of Lord Vishnu. So killing whale shark is almost equivalent to Devhatya. So killing the god. So don't do that. So there were multiple methods of campaign. So everything worked out really well. And the fisher folks started to release whale shark from 2004 onwards. So till date, from 2004 when we started the campaign till date, the fisher folks of Gujarat coast along with the project team and with the forest department have rescued and released close to 800 whale sharks, 789 whale sharks. That's a real good number. So along with that, we are also using the modern tools as well. So whenever the fishers are rescuing the whale shark by cutting the net, there is some cost involved in it. Because if you're cutting the net, which is almost like 2 kilometers in length, they have to go for fishing next day, right? So with the damaged net, they won't be able to go. So for that, forest department is giving the compensation. So what we have assisted the forest department by creating the mobile app so that there's a proper documentation of the whale shark rescue also. So the number which I told you about, say like 789 whale shark. So these are properly documented using mobile apps so that there should not be any issues. So this mobile app, so we are using the modern day technology for the conservation. And we are also training the fisher folks to become acquainted with this kind of modern tools so that they can contribute very much towards the conservation. It's something like a citizen science initiative also. So as I told you, there are lots of science involved along with this thing. So apart from the conservation, apart from the campaign, we are also doing lots of science in this project. So here, as I told you, the dots and stripes of the whale sharks are really, really unique. So if you can take a photograph of the whale shark, that photograph can be compared with the photographs which is already existing in the library, and you can clearly make out that whether that particular whale shark is unique to that particular region or whether that whale shark has been identified elsewhere in the distribution range. So there is a organization called Eco Ocean. So this organization is based in Australia, and this Eco Ocean is the organization largely documenting the and cataloging these photographs of whale shark all along the coast, all along the Indian coast as well as along the globe. So there are lots of science involved in this thing. Apart from that, we are also doing, the project team in Gujarat have done satellite tracking. So most of you must be knowing what exactly the satellite tracking means. So for them, somebody does not know what exactly the satellite tracking is, we will attach the satellite transmitters onto the whale shark. So whenever whale shark moves, we will get the information about the animal, where exactly it's moving, how it's moving, in what direction it's moving. So satellite tagging is not only for whale sharks. Satellite tags, we can put it on any marine animal. Say we have done satellite tracking of tuna fishes, marine turtles, dolphins, whales, etc. So those who are familiar with the terrestrial environment, you also might be knowing that tigers, leopards, lions, elephants, rhinos, almost all the large bodied animals have been satellite tagged. Birds also, lots of birds, say like Amur falcon have tagged. So satellite tags actually help to understand the migratory behavior of the animals. So this is basically a scientific tool. So far under this project, we have tagged 8 whale sharks from the Gujarat coast. So we have used this multiple tags. One is the floating tag, which you can see towards the right hand top corner. And here on the middle, you can see the fin mount tag. So these are various type of tags we have used to understand the movement migration of the whale sharks. So this image will give you an idea about, these are the data which we have retrieved from one of the tags for a brief period of time. So these blue dots, you can see that these are the movement path of the whale shark, which was tagged from the Gujarat coast. So we tagged the animal over here from the Gujarat, from the Saurashtra coast. Then that animal was traveling all the way from south, going to the Maldives. From there it was moving, it actually went to the Somalian coast and came back to Maldives. So via Maldives, it went to Somalian coast and came to Maldives again. So these are the information which we get from the satellite tagging, and we are doing these things also. So another interesting thing is that, as I told you in the beginning, our understanding about the whale shark is really, really less. We really don't know where they breed, where they give birth to the young ones. Interestingly, what happened is that along the Gujarat coast, we have got almost like 5 neonatal whale sharks. That means the whale shark which is less than 70 centimeters. Okay, it's really good to see. Okay, so we are talking about an adult whale shark which is almost close to 41 feet or close to 12 meters. And the baby whale shark is only less than 70 centimeters. So it's a tiny little animal. I think I'll play this video once again. You will be able to see that this is a neonate whale shark which was rescued by a fisherman in the Gujarat coast. It's really small. So like that, we have got almost like 5 neonate whale shark from the Gujarat coast. So this is a clear indication that the Gujarat waters are the breeding ground for the whale sharks. So apart from the neonate whale shark, we got 5. Apart from that, we have got almost like 3-4 pre-juvenile whale shark also. So that the size of those whale sharks are from, say, like 70 centimeters to 200 centimeter. So we are getting the juvenile whale sharks, also the neonatal whale shark. So these are really interesting piece of information we have gathered with the support of the fisher folks. So we believe in the citizen science and active participation of the fishing community. So till now, so I would like to say that from 2004 to 2020, there are not any reports of intentional killing of whale shark from Gujarat waters. So I would like to say that Gujarat waters are a safe haven for, say, for whale sharks. I would like to say that the effort of Wildlife Trust of India, the Tata Chemicals and the Gujarat Forest Department, and the hard effort of the fisher folks along the coast have paid success for the protection of the whale sharks along the Gujarat coast. But if you say the other coastal region of India are not very welcoming for whale sharks. So that is a little alarming, because the whale sharks which we are trying to protect and safeguarding along the Gujarat coast are being killed in the other coastal areas of India. So keeping this thing in mind, we initiated another project along the Kerala coast. So what happened is that, just like following the Gujarat model, this Kerala project was also successful. So it's an ongoing project, and it's a very recently initiated project, which is only 3 years back. So in last three years, the fisher folks of Kerala have rescued and released almost 2 whale sharks. So that is also a really interesting piece of information, and that's a really good effort by the fisher folks. They have cut the net and they have released the whale sharks. So that's a really appreciable effort by the fishers of Kerala. So I would like to conclude the talk. So this particular project was made possible with lots of partnership from India as well as abroad. So I would like to thank all of them for their generous support. Before winding up, I would like to show you a small cartoon, so you'll be able to kind of see this thing. So here, the major problem here is that we really don't know about the species. So ignorance is one of the major issue what we are facing. So through this small interactive webinars, what we are trying to make is that to make the people aware about the importance of sharks and whale sharks, so that they can go and teach others. So if there is awareness among ourselves, we'll be able to understand the beauty of the species. We will try to understand more about the habitats. We'll try to safeguard and protect these species. So for that, we need to create awareness. So this kind of platform are really essential to kind of make the people aware about the elusive species. So ignorance is the major deterrent factor. So don't be ignorant. Try to learn and share the information what you have learned from here with other people as well. So well before ending, I would also like to kind of add a couple of lines about how you can contribute. Okay, so it's not these kind of talks are not only just meant to kind of listen and just kind of forget. What you can contribute, how you can contribute. Okay, so as I told you, whale sharks are filter feeders, and plastic pollution is one of the major threat to the ocean. So being an animal like a filter feeder, which actually filters the seawater, the ocean pollution, so largely the ocean plastic pollution or the microplastics are one of the major deterrent for whale shark population. So be compassionate citizen, try to use less amount of plastic, and tell the same thing to your parents and relatives and friends to reduce the use of plastic. If at all you are using the plastic, ensure that you are disposing it properly, because ultimately most of the things which you dump carelessly ultimately get landed up in the ocean. So even though you are living on a hilly area or a non-coastal area, you say that, okay, I am not living in the coastal area, so I am not creating any problem for the whale sharks, for the ocean life. It's not really true. Wherever you live, whether a coastal area or a non-coastal area, whatever small bit of action you are doing, that can have an adverse effect on the species and habitats of the ocean. So be compassionate citizen. So try to be very compassionate for yourself and all for the other species and habitats. So that's all from me. So hope you all got an idea about the sharks and the whale shark conservation which we are involved with. So here I have given my email ID if you want to know more about the sharks or more about the project, and if you want to volunteer, if you want to kind of associate to get associated with the project, so be in touch. we'll be there. Thank you. Thank you a lot for your patient listening.
Sir, thank you so much, sir.
Thank you.
Sir, thank you so much.
Thank you. Can you hear me? Yes, yeah.
Yes, sir.
Thanks, Ramji. Thanks, Ramji.
Sir, the question is visible, sir.
Yeah, yeah. So it's visible. Okay, yeah. So how long does a bowhead whale live? Okay. So the thing is that, it's a different thing question, okay. So I was talking about whale shark. I think I missed that particular part to say. Okay. So whale sharks are sharks. Okay. Here we are talking about a whale. Okay. Whale is a mammal. Okay. So my whole talk was about whale sharks. The shark is a fish. Whale is a mammal. Okay. So if I put it into this perspective that I never talked about whale here. Okay. I was talking about whale shark. Okay. Bowhead whale being a mammal, that will be living close to 75 years, but I am not an expert on bowhead whales. Okay, so this question about whales, so I may not be in a right person to answer about whales. I can answer about whale sharks. Again, the questions are coming on whales. I would like to say that I talked about whale shark, which is a fish. Whales are mammals. Okay. So my expertise on whales are really, really less. So my understanding is really less on whales. Okay, so the question is that what are the favorable factors for the breeding of whale shark in Gujarat coast? Okay, so I would like to say that we really don't know what are the favorable factors. So far, we have got the whale shark pups from that region. So the larger assumption is that the whale shark pups being really, really small, only 70 centimeters, and they have a really underdeveloped muscles, they cannot undergo long distance migration. So if the pups are found in one particular region, it's the assumption that the whale sharks are breeding in that region itself. So the question is about why the whale sharks are picking Gujarat coast for breeding, right? So we really don't have a clear answer, but exactly the thing is that during the time from October to April, there is a shrimp called Acetus, small prawn. So we call it as paste shrimp. So there's over growth of these kind of shrimps in that region. So during this particular time, say from October to April. So as I told you, whale sharks being the filter feeder, they largely feeds on prawns, shrimps, planktons, and other fish larvae. So this presence of this Acetus shrimp can be one of the reason for the species to be hanging around in that particular region. But still, we really don't have a clear understanding why whale sharks are preferring Gujarat coast. That's an interesting thing. We really don't know about the gestation period of this thing. So that's why I told you, we really don't know when they mate, how they mate. Our information is very, very less. So that's why I told that even though the whale shark is a huge fish, the largest fish in the world, our understanding about the whale shark is only tiny, only this much. So we really don't know what is the gestation period of this thing. And gestation period is a term largely used for mammals. So we don't use gestation period for species like sharks, which give which lay egg within. So oviparous. Yeah. So it's almost like the same question. So we really don't have a clear answer for this thing. So maybe the Acetus shrimp distribution along the coast maybe can be one of the reason for the species to aggregate along the Gujarat coast. But along with Gujarat coast, if you come down south along the west coast, Maharashtra, Karnataka, Lakshadweep, and towards the east coast, along Andhra Pradesh coast also, we have small aggregations of whale sharks. It has been recorded, but the largest aggregation is along the Gujarat coast, and we don't have a clear answer why they aggregate in this large number in that region. Okay, so that's a really good one. Okay, so there are no clear, what is a guidelines to become a scientist on a sharks. It's all about your passion and how you take this passion forward. So if you want to be a conservationist who are working on sharks, you can get a degree in marine biology. Okay, so there are lots of colleges or lots of universities, not too many, but yeah, many universities provide a degree in marine biology. So you can apply, you can appear for any of the All India entrances and get yourself enrolled in any of the marine biology course, marine science course. You can first of all learn about the marine science, then learn about the sharks in general, then you can start working on the marine species, any of the marine species. So there are no strict guidelines of becoming a scientist on sharks. So just follow your passion. Shark is important for environment. Yes, yeah, sharks are very important for environment. So for that matter, I will say that not only sharks, all the species are very important for environment. Sharks are very important for the marine environment because they are the apex predator. So in the food pyramid, whichever is on the top, which is on the pinnacle of that food pyramid, plays an important role in the entire regulation of the ecological health of that particular ecosystem. So being the shark, the apex predator on the marine food pyramid, sharks are very important for the oceans. What are the threats to the whale shark? Yes, okay. So the major threats to the whale shark are from human beings. Hunting is one of the major threat. They are commercially exploited all along the coast. So it's not direct hunting. People, nobody is, not a single fisherman from India will go say that, okay, I will hunt whale shark today. They will not get it. So this is something called accidental entanglement. Okay, so they'll put the fishing net to catch some other fish, but whale shark being the largest fish, they'll get entangled in the fishing net. Okay, so accidental mortality is one thing. So whenever there is an accidental mortality, what will happen is that fishermen will bring that fish to the landing center and they cut it and they'll sell it. So one is the fishing is one of the largest threat. Second threat is the offshore vessel movement. So the ships, small ships, boats, everything, they, since they are using the ocean for their the same transport and other purpose, and whale shark being one of the largest fish, getting rammed by the vessels are really, really high. So one is accidental entanglement, second one is vessel traffic, and third and most important one is ocean pollution. Plastic pollution is one of the major threat for the whale sharks. How acts are, okay, so you are talking about various, assume that your question is about various wildlife protection rules. Yeah, so whale sharks are listed under the Schedule 1 of the Indian Wildlife Protection Act. So, and you may be knowing that Indian Wildlife Protection Act is one of the stringent, policy document in the country. So, and Schedule 1 is the prime. So there is nothing beyond that. So Schedule 1 of the Indian Wildlife Protection Act means that you are not supposed to touch that animal. You are not supposed to do anything with that animal. You cannot touch it. You cannot kill it. You cannot see that animal. So there are lots of regulations. But the regulations are very strict on the paper. But on the real thing, the fish is not getting that much of attention. So it's not enjoying that much of protection in the real life. So the protection is high in the paper, but on the real life scenario, it's not very strong. So whale sharks are hunted all along the coast. So I would like to say that the protection, I mean, the acts are not really helping the animals for time being. Hopefully it will get, we all can work together. Thank you, Kumaresh. Thank you.
That's the last question, sir.
Okay. Is there any harmful effect in the global warming towards the very... Okay, fine. So this is a question more general. So here I will not differentiate between whale and a whale shark. So global warming is having serious effect on the marine life as such. So you must be knowing about ocean sea level rise. Sea level rise is one thing. And the thing is that if you remember, I have showed a small map of the distribution of whale sharks. They prefer the tropics. Okay, so what is happening is that they really don't prefer the temperate or the cold waters. They prefer the tropics and subtropical region. But because of the global warming, the sea is getting warmed up. Okay, so because of this particular thing, what is happening is that the whale sharks are slowly migrating towards the poles. Okay, so the distribution. So we are getting whale sharks from the remote places where there were no records of whale sharks. So they are slowly migrating towards the, what is it, above the tropics, north tropics, and what is it, the southern part. So the distribution, entire distribution of the whale sharks will get affected. Not only the whale shark, other large bodied animals, say like other marine megafauna, also will get affected due to global climate change. Apart from that, the small creatures. So the advantage of the large bodied animal is that since they have really developed muscles, they can clearly move from a place when it's an adverse thing. Okay. So, but small bodied animals or small creatures may not be able to kind of cope up with this kind of climate variation. So, for example, this plankton, small fishes, etc. So they will perish. So if those kind of species are dying out, they are perishing, that will having a direct effect on the food pyramid or the food chain. So that will cascade into different levels. So just like the effect of climate change on the terrestrial environment, the same threat are there on the ocean ecosystem as well.
Okay, sir. Thank you, sir. It's a time to conclude, sir.
Okay, thank you.
Okay, thank you so much for giving such a beautiful explanation about the whale shark today. Thank you very much, sir. And I also thank WTA also. And I also thank our management and the principals and my colleagues and my students. And the real success behind the webinar is our resource person and the participant. Without them, it won't be possible. Thank you so much, Anandal. Thank you, sir.
Thank you. Thank you all.
Thank you. Thank you, sir. Thank you. Participants, I have sent a feedback link to mail ID. Thank you. Thank you very much.